These trainers are ready to go. Let's take to the stage for our first ever grand finals for Pokemon Go here at the World Championships.
One more time, we glide down to center stage. This is it. Tell your friends, tell your family, everyone who's interested in Pokemon Go needs to see this. A champion is sitting on this stage. We just don't know which seat.
I mean, you have a 50-50 chance, and I know that will probably anger some of the video game players out there, as it's not usually favorable when you phrase it that way, but you know that one of these two trainers will be walking home with the title of first ever Masters Division Pokemon Go World Champion. Is it gonna be Godan Hada from Korea, or is it gonna be Dancing Rob from Germany? Let us know if you're watching at home via Twitch chat who you're rooting for, what Pokemon you wanna see win. Do you wanna see the Altaria? Do you wanna see the Shadow Venusaur? Are you rooting for Godan Hada? Are you rooting for Dancing Rob? Now is the time to make some noise to support your favorite Pokemon trainer, as this is it. This is the final countdown to that world champion title.
It's the final countdown, and these are the final two trainers left here today in London. The first ever World Championships are underway, and I cannot wait to get started here. For both of these trainers, this needs to be their finest hour to succeed. But I'll tell you what, there's so many obstacles here, so many barriers. If you look at these team compositions, starting with Godan Hada, we've seen this team several times, but how it pairs up against Dancing Robs is key. Shadow Walrein, Medicham, Altaria, Lickitung, Shadow, Kanto, Ninetales, and that Registeel. How does that look against Dancing Rob's team?
Well, if you're just tuning in, Dancing Rob showcasing a lovely team of the Medicham, Lickitung, Shadow Venusaur, Shadow Swampert, Alolan Ninetales, and Galarian Stunfisk has a few interesting matchups. You know, you look at the Shadow Kanto Ninetales, the Altaria, the Lickitung on Godan Hada's side of the field, and it looks like Dancing Rob does have answers for those Pokemon. He just has to be very careful. You know, as much as we've been talking about how that Shadow Venusaur is his signature Pokemon and how much work it did for him just recently in the Losers Finals here at the World Championships, I don't think you can really bring it into this matchup safely because there's just too much on Godan Hada's side of the field that can answer it.
That's a fantastic team composition read there as well. There's so many obstacles to thriving in the same way that he's done throughout this tournament. As a reminder, as a refresher for everyone watching at home, this is essentially a Gary and Ash situation. Dancing Rob has conquered the rest of the field. He is meeting his final opponent here, Gary, if you will, on the left, just waiting that final challenger, but he has to defeat him not once, but twice to secure this Grand Finals Championship, and he has to do it in a best of five each and every time. And like you said, a very inhospitable environment for this Venusaur to thrive. So how can Dancing Rob dance around the situation and figure out how else he can win this series?
We just saw Dancing Rob use the Galarian Stunfisk on his team to power through the Registeel on the opposing side of the field. And I think that if you're looking at what Godan Hada is bringing and what Pokemon are going to be on paper the most consistent Pokemon in this matchup, you know that Registeel has to be lurking somewhere in the distance. So I think you have to bring the Stunfisk. You have to make sure you have a game plan, because if you don't, Registeel is one of those Pokemon that will just run straight through your team. Yes, it doesn't deal much damage with those fast moves, but after a while, the Zap Cannon attack drops and the Focus Blast just add up to deal so much damage.
There are some functionalities for certain Pokemon. For example, a Pokemon like Drifblim with Icy Wind has great setup potential for the rest of its team. It doesn't hit very hard with its other charge attacks, but it can really help the other Pokemon succeed, whereas other Pokemon like Swampert are all charge attack oriented, and Registeel finds itself somewhere in the middle with attacks like Zap Cannon and Focus Blast. It's not only a heavy hitter, but a setup Pokemon as well, and the setup is complete. We have our leads on the field.
Registeel versus Galarian Stunfisk in game one of the grand finals here at the World Championships. Galarian Stunfisk happy to take the lead in terms of the type advantage. advantage in terms of the attack, but that Registeel gets the Focus Blast just a split second quicker.
We see the Registeel striking here first, but Dancing Rob wants to protect this Galarian Stunfisk. He recognizes this is a key matchup. He's going to throw the Earthquake here as well, looking to deliver some damage onto the Registeel. Do we see an early Protect Shield from our Gauden Trainer as well? And we do not. Actually, Earthquake comes through.
Earthquake will come through, but it'll take one more Earthquake or possibly even a Rock Slide, depending on how low that Registeel's health gets. But Dancing Rob, not wanting to take any chances, just goes straight for the second Earthquake. Godanada letting the Registeel go.
Looking to bury that Registeel under those ground-type attacks and succeeds. This is a very precarious position now because you can't deal super effective damage with either of your Pokemon here if you're Godanada.
It's going to be a tough matchup as well, since that Medicham on Dancing Rob's side of the field is happy to switch in onto this Walrein and start dealing some big damage. Not going to shield this Icicle Sphere, does a good amount of damage to that Medicham, but I think more importantly, banking that energy for later, as this Medicham does not have power-up punch available to it. It's going to really have to rely on its fast move for damage.
And we've seen Dancing Rob pick the right Pokemon in the key moments, recognizing the Medicham is critical. He does leave it in there, give it a Protect Shield. He's going to throw an Ice Punch now against the Lickitung. Now, the challenge this Fighting and Psychic-type Pokemon has is that there's just so much bulk to punch through, and it does pull away that Protect Shield, but Medicham is now dangerously low.
It is, and will have the opportunity to throw a Psychic here at least before it has to worry about being knocked out, and the Psychic will connect, but Godanada still has one shield available, but the defense drop comes through.
The defense drop comes through. That's a great setup here as the Medicham will go down from the Body Slam. We're going to see another Pokemon come in here, but this Lickitung is severely weakened, and that extra Protect Shield is not going to be that useful.
It isn't, and Charm just does so much damage, and you cannot stop that with a Protect Shield. Lickitung does get to the Body Slam in time to deal some threatening damage to this Alolan Ninetales, but it's nowhere near enough for that KO, and Charm is able just to knock it straight out.
Alolan Ninetales really flexing its fast attack pressure as it looks to charm down the Shadow Walrein, and it will. Dancing Rob takes game number one.
He is one game closer to resetting the bracket, but I think the Alolan Ninetales really was his key to victory in that matchup, which means Godanada really has to think twice about how he's going to approach this game. You would think that the Registeel would be the perfect Pokemon to take down that Alolan Ninetales, but he let it get knocked out so early on in that matchup, it just wasn't available. And Dancing Rob, I think very smartly, kept that Ninetales a secret until it was guaranteed the victory thanks to that fast move pressure.
Just like you mentioned, there's a lot of pressure here from Godanada's team to kind of push that Alolan Ninetales onto the bench for Dancing Rob, kind of force it off the field so it doesn't arrive. The Registeel, the Shadow Kanto Ninetales, there are a lot of immediate threats to that Pokemon. So Rob bringing it in that very first opening game shows that he is a trainer that has nothing to lose. He's going to put it all on the table and try to secure a victory.
And that's exactly what you have to do when you're coming in on the loser's side of the bracket and you want to be the first ever Pokemon Go world champion. You really have to be absolutely on top of your game. You have to be able to predict what your opponent is going to bring and position accordingly. I think if I were Dancing Rob, the other question I would be asking myself is it even worth it to bring the Alolan Ninetales a second time, or is the threat of it enough at this team preview phase?
We've seen some trainers, for example, in an earlier set, we saw the Altaria really wreak havoc on their opponent's team when they doubled down on a strategy that did not directly address it. So again, these trainers are kind of feeling each other out throughout this matchup. Is my opponent going to double down? Are they going to be aggressive here? Or can I find other ways to win? Can I double down on my own strategies, trust in my Pokemon, and find those win conditions on my own? We have one trainer that's already locked in. They are certain about their approach to this game number two. And one trainer is taking just a couple moments, but not too long. Here we go. We are set up for game number two, Dancing Rob versus Godanada.
All right, it is the Shadow Kanto Ninetales on the field versus the Galarian Stunfisk. And once again, we're in an interesting position where both of these Pokemon are doing super effective damage to one another, but Godanada is going to have to invest some shields if he wants to win this matchup.
I like this play a lot. Recognizing the counts, throwing that Rock Slide to draw away the Protect Shield just before the Shadow Kanto Ninetales gets to that Weather Ball. But now the Medicham comes in, and look here, building up to an overheat, and Dancing Rob respects it.
Dancing Rob with this shield not only will not take damage from this weather ball, but I think more importantly will get this Medicham into a position where it can start to threaten some damage on its own. This time lets the attack connect from the Shadow Canto Ninetales, and it's another weather ball.
The weather ball does connect, dealing some meaningful damage to that Medicham as it looks to build up additional energy, throwing a psychic here as well. We know the Ice Punch is resisted and not same type attack bonus, but it's critical here. Oh, maybe calling an Ice Punch. Golden Hada lets that Ninetales go.
Doesn't choose to invest the double shields on the Shadow Canto Ninetales this time around, but I think that is for the best, given that both the Registeel and the Lickitung in the back of his party is going to be taking some serious damage from this Medicham.
Medicham delivering a Psychic here. Do we see a Protect Shield? There's only one remaining on the board, and no Protect Shield. Psychic does come through here as well as Medicham warps that kinetic energy. Here we see a Glaring Stunfisk come in to match a Lickitung. This is a bit tough, but this Lickitung will strike first.
Power Whip is the move of choice, and Dancing Rob just content to let it go, as it won't threaten a KO. It will need some additional damage first, and this Galarian Stunfisk building up to almost two rock slides before deciding to throw the Earthquake. If Godan Hada decides to shield this attack, that Lickitung will certainly be able to hang around, and he does call the bait correctly.
Incredible shield call there on that Earthquake. We're gonna look at the Lickitung trying to pace to a charge attack, but this Galarian Stunfisk will reach a rock slide first. Again, kind of adjusting their routes, adjusting the plans and the projections as these matchups evolve and change. We do see the rock slide connect. Do we get a full lick down? I think we do. Lickitung looks hungry. It's ready for the
so
Stunfisk.
So close, but the Stunfisk is able to get to the rock slide because Godan Hada takes that last half of a second turn to switch in the Registeel to take this rock slide.
What an incredible swap in, recognizing you can't exactly secure the lick on down, but the Swampert is out here. We've seen Dancing Rob really just pummel his opponents with this Pokemon.
Yeah, the Registeel will get to the Focus Blast first, but if Dancing Rob decides to, that shield is ready and waiting to keep that Swampert safe until it reaches the Earthquake in just a couple more turns.
Look at this recognition of the energy intervals, building up so much extra Mudshot energy, throwing the Hydro Cannon here as well. I think Swampert wants to escape this matchup with a charge attack so that it can KO the Lickitung in some eventuality, but it's going to need to double up here, and it does get the double.
Yeah, that Swampert throwing that Hydro Cannon just as the Registeel gets to its charged moves. This will connect and knock out. And provided the Swampert immediately goes for the second Hydro Cannon, it's able to knock out this Lickitung. And Dancing Rob is up 2-0 against Godan Hada.
Dancing Rob doing his best to wash away the competition there as the Lickitung does faint, going up 2-0 in the series. And suddenly, Godan Hada is 1 game away from a bracket reset. And then it's just a best of 5 from there.
Yeah, Dancing Rob taking an early advantage here, which must feel pretty great, you know, when you're coming up into the grand finals from the loser side of the bracket. Again, you have to win the first set, force a bracket reset, and then you really are vying for that title of world champion. And I think if I were in Godan Hada's shoes, I might be a little bit nervous now. You know, that felt like a very comfortable win, both those games from Dancing Rob, game one with the Alolan Ninetales, game two with that Shadow Swampert. I think that Godan Hada has to start making some reads here during team preview to figure out what the best strategy is, as Dancing Rob feels like he's consistently one step ahead at team preview.
Well, let me ask you this. So Dancing Rob is already up 2-0 here in the loser's bracket. He knows he needs one more win to secure the victory. He's left that Venusaur on the bench as we expected. Is this a key moment for Dancing Rob to pull something out of his hat and try to bring out that Shadow Venusaur and maybe throw his opponent off guard here? I think it would be very favorable in a lot of key matchups. However, if Godan Hada doubles down on the Registeel or the Shadow Canto Ninetales, Venusaur might have nowhere to go. Maybe it's too risky.
I don't know. I think that's what Godan Hada was expecting in that game too, as if you recall, he did double down with those two Pokemon. And it is Dancing Rob's signature Pokemon of this tournament. You know, I think the temptation would certainly be there, but you still have one best of 5 set to win. If you want to bring that signature Pokemon, if you want to bring your first partner Pokemon into battle, you need to have the utmost confidence that that battle will go in your favor. And I think there is just too much on the line right now for Dancing Rob to take that risk. Once the bracket reset goes through, if it goes through, I think then you can start taking those chances a bit more, as again, you're just so much closer to the title of world champion. You can breathe a little bit easier.
I think so as well. There's still a tremendous amount of pressure here on Dancing Rob. Godin Hada really feeling out his opponent here, but we have a lock-in. Both of these trainers are ready for what could be a decisive game three in this set, and we have the Ninetales on the field.
Shadow Kanto Ninetales versus the Alolan Ninetales. Both of these forms, Dancing Rob immediately switching out into that Medicham to take on this Ninetales once again.
Now we've seen this Shadow Kanto Ninetales built to overheat and throw a bait. This time just the Weather Ball gets shielded as Dancing Rob really wants to maintain the switch advantage. He recognizes that HP on his own Medicham is critical.
But Godin Hada brings in his own Medicham for the matchup. And interestingly enough, Godin Hada has access to power-up punch, where Dancing Rob only has ice punch.
Great early shield there by Godin Hada, as well as he does protect against that psychic. And this is interesting because he's keeping the Medicham away from the Alolan Ninetales that Dancing Rob had in the lead. We see a psychic come here from Godin Hada, and this will connect as Dancing Rob's Medicham is starting to struggle a bit.
Just a couple more attacks before Dancing Rob's Medicham will be knocked out. But first, we'll get to this next psychic. Godin Hada saving the shield for later. While this won't be enough for the knockout, I think the thing that I'm paying attention to is whether or not Godin Hada is going to throw a power-up punch here, or if he's just going to try to farm that Pokemon down.
Instantaneous, no shield here, reaching for the ice punch. Godin Hada knows his counts. He knows the Medicham did not muster enough energy for the psychic, and he does secure the knockout. One shield each, but here comes a powerful psychic from the Medicham. Medicham looks to clap its hands and deliver a blow here to the Alolan Ninetales.
That Alolan Ninetales is at full health, but is now closer to half of its health remaining as the Medicham is knocked out as well. Dancing Rob looking to switch almost instantaneously to the Galarian Stunfisk as the Ninetales is revealed once again, but now it's the Lickitung out on the field for Godin Hada.
I just think it's important here to not count out Dancing Rob in this matchup. This Galarian Stunfisk has been so powerful for him, but an early no shield is a huge setback as well. A lot of these Galarian Stunfisks like to throw that Earthquake early because the Lickitung can absorb it.
But in this case, Lickitung just keeping that shield for later, and that's the kind of play that Godin Hada needs to start focusing on. This Power Whip will not connect with the Galarian Stunfisk on Rob's side of the field, but here comes the Earthquake, and Godin Hada decides not to shield this time around.
Godin Hada letting this damage through. He knows he only has one protection remaining, and he wants to conserve it. He's going to look to deliver another Power Whip here. Will he get there in time? And he does, but it's a charge move priority, and the Galarian Stunfisk is being just annoyingly persistent in this matchup.
Yeah, that Galarian Stunfisk has a higher attack stat, which means these attacks will go through first and get the knock out first. Now that Ninetales drawn back out onto the field, but certainly does have the type advantage here. But Dancing Rob switching in his own Ninetales to try and take a possible Weather Ball. Godin Hada not calling it and waiting to throw until he had two instead.
Godin Hada does not take that Ice and Fairy type Pokemon bait, instead building to double charge attacks, just like we saw Dancing Rob do in the previous game. And these back-to-backs are going to close this game out.
All right, Godin Hada finally taking his first win in this grand final sets. Two wins away from winning the title of world champion. Dancing Rob still one win away from resetting the bracket. It's just getting closer and closer to the wire here in London.
Well, I think that just shows these trainers' grits. I think you don't want to give your opponent an advantage. And if you have the opportunity to close this tournament out right here and right now, you might as well just go for it. So we're going to see these trainers try every trick in the book, pull every resource out of their bags, and try to really apply pressure to their opponent. They are not going to go away quietly. And Dancing Rob is only one win away. But if another win from Godin Hada comes through, suddenly the stakes are very, very high.
Yeah, being in a position where the winner of the match determines the fate of the tournament, whether or not we get a bracket reset, would certainly be exciting, as I think many of our international level tournaments have reached that level. But for now, we must play the game in front of us. We must focus on the matchup in front of us. And again, we still haven't seen that Shadow Venusaur from Dancing Rob, but I really don't think we're gonna see it again. It's just not the right matchup for it. And I have to wonder if that's something that Godan Hada recognizes or if he's worried that the Venusaur is finally going to be making an appearance.
Venusaur can be incredibly oppressive, and we've been talking about this a lot. This Pokemon feels like a specter that's just haunting the stage. It might appear, it might not, it might cause havoc, or it might get hard countered. Such a tricky Pokemon, but we've seen Dancing Rob really rely on more neutral play, reaching for those other tools in his toolkit, leveraging the Galarian Stunfisk, the Swampert, making close matchups winnable, and just staying in this competition as long as he can. I think we're going to see some more variety from these trainers as they look to secure another win. But Godan Hada, again, just needs two victories to silence his opponent and become the first ever champion, whereas Dancing Rob needs to force the reset to give himself an opportunity.
One of these trainers is locked in and ready to go. The other is waiting and just making sure they picture every single possible victory. There is so much you have to keep track of in key matchups like this, especially when they're best of five matchups. That's just more games that you have to remember, more strategies that you have to recognize as possibilities from your opponents. But a huge mix-up from Godan Hada in this game four. Altaria is the Pokemon leading versus the Medicham.
Medicham can strike for double super effective damage with the Ice Punch, but can it reach it in time? And it does not want to take a Sky Tech either, so this Altaria does apply a very, very hard shield pressure. We do see the first Ice Punch get triggered here, excuse me.
Thankfully, the Altaria can take a single Ice Punch, but will not be able to take two. And these charged moves take so long to charge up for it. While it will get the opportunity to throw a Sky Attack here, it's blocked by a shield on Dancing Rob's side of the field, and there might not be enough time for it to get to a second.
Medicham reaching for a second Ice Punch here, looking to freeze the Altaria out of the sky, but it does not want to go away just yet. It does leverage that Protect Shield to save itself from this damage and then try to push for another Sky Attack. Do we see a switch out? His finger's awfully close to the button.
I think Godan Hada was thinking about it, but ultimately deciding to throw a second Sky Attack, and Dancing Rob letting this one through for the knockout. Down to his final two Pokemon. That Stunfisk comes out onto the field, but the Lickitung is right behind it to take those ground-type attacks.
And we just saw this matchup earlier. We know the early Earthquake seems to be the prescription, and Godan Hada does not shield this one either. This is going to be a lot of damage, but again, Lickitung, one of the bulkiest Pokemon in all of Open Great League, can definitely take a hit.
It can, and it can certainly fire back once it gets all charged up and ready to go. I find it interesting that Godan Hada has consistently waited until he's had half of a Power Whip to throw the first Power Whip against this Stunfisk. It doesn't do a lot of damage, so being able to carry that energy over is certainly very wise. But do you shield this time around? If you don't shield, that Earthquake brings you down into the red.
Lickitung might push for another Power Whip. Can it get there? And
it got there. It got there. And now Dancing Rob decides to forego the use of a shield as well. And this Power Whip is allowed to connect.
It's going to come down to a very close matchup here as the Swampert gets one additional Mudshot due to the switch in. We see the Medicham come out to answer it. And the bad news is that this is a power up punch Medicham. It's really going to turn the screws against the Swampert.
Waiting until he gets a Psychic, but throwing the power-up punch against the Shadow Swampert, and Dancing Rob uses his final shield to block the damage.
That Medicham does get the attack boost, but Shadow Swampert is not out of it yet, looking to deliver a Hydro Cannon here, and we do see a no Protect Shield as well from Godan Hada.
A risky play as that Swampert still has a Hydro Cannon available to it, but Medicham finds the opportunity to throw a second power-up punch, get a second attack boost, and again, threatens so much damage against the Stunfisk and the Swampert remaining, but the Swampert throws that Hydro Cannon straight into the final Protect Shield of Godan Hada.
There is no opportunity to switch out here. There is no other option but to achieve victory as this Medicham punches its way through that Galarian Stunfisk and secures a win. We are all tied up.
The winner of this next game will determine if we will be crowning our first ever Masters Division Pokemon Go champion, or if we'll be heading straight into a bracket reset. And I cannot stress just how exciting it is that we are here in game five, once again, of a grand finals for the Pokemon Go Championship Series. And what an incredible set it's been so far.
game five here. This is going to be fascinating to watch how these trainers address their opponents. Do we finally see that Shadow Venusaur? Has there been too many obstacles in its way? Will it make an appearance? Will that Swampert really shine here as well? The Altaria shakeup, like you mentioned at the opening of that matchup, was so fascinating to watch because it really kind of put Dancing Rob on his back heel, but he needs just one more win to stay in this tournament, whereas Godin Hada is 3 minutes away from glory.
I gotta say, the fact that Altaria was able to catch that Medicham as well as a lead really worked out well for Godin Hada. I don't think that's something that Dancing Rob will let Godin Hada do again. I think if you're assuming that we're going to see a second appearance of that Altaria, you know your opponent's going to lead something that at least has a more favorable matchup against it. You have to be very careful. That being said, Altaria is a great Pokemon on paper, as it's been able to handle a lot of the threats that Dancing Rob has been bringing to this matchup overall. And of course, if that Shadow Venusaur does finally make an appearance, you know it's going to win that matchup quite comfortably.
Like we mentioned before, when you have a Swampert and a Venusaur on opposing sides, or even a Water type and a Grass type, these dominant typing matchups, you really have to control positioning. And when you lock in a game and a strategy, you really have to stick to the script and do your best to write your story. But we have both of our trainers locked in. We are in London, and this is where legends are made.
We're going to begin game five of the grand finals here at the Pokemon World Championships. Shadow Kanto Ninetales against the Galarian Stunfisk for Dancing Rob.
Now we know these rock slides will do super effective damage to that Shadow Kanto Ninetales. We've seen early protect shields as well. Godin Hada investing in his Pokemon, but we do not see it this time actually opting for the no shield.
That Ninetales is able to hold on through one rock slide, but that Medicham taking the field, and now the Altaria is staring it down once again.
Wow, this Altaria again dealing so much damage with these Dragon Breaths. Actually, no shielding the first Ice Punch as well. We know Altaria can withstand one of these, but not two, as Godin Hada looks to continue his control of this Game 5 matchup.
Yeah, saving these shields for as late as possible in the game. Dancing Rob deciding to shield immediately for this Sky Attack, knowing that it would be enough to knock out the Medicham. And the fact that the Medicham is already at a second Ice Punch throws it just a couple of seconds before the Altaria gets to the next Sky Attack, and Godin Hada finally going for a shield.
And we've seen this matchup play out in a similar way in an earlier game. One Protect Shield each. The Altaria is approaching the Sky Attack, pulls the trigger just a half second earlier, and the same result. The Medicham will get knocked out here by the Sky Attack.
Dancing Rob has two options to bring out onto the field, and it's going to be the return of the Galarian Stunfisk. Will threaten a ton of damage with these rock slides, but for now, happy to farm up as much energy as it can for the later parts of the match, because you know that Shadow Kanto Ninetales is still there waiting to use those super effective fire type attacks against it.
It definitely has it. Oh, a match of disadvantage, but here comes the rock slide as the Shadow Kanto Ninetales gets sacrificed over to the Galarian Stunfisk here that does super effective damage and secures the knockout. We're going to see the Swampert coming here. He's furiously tapping on that button on the right side.
Typically, you only see Pokemon catch charge moves like that when the trainer is out of shields, but Godin Hada just using that option a little bit early on in this matchup. Now Lickitung gets to face off against the Shadow Swampert. Doesn't throw the Power Whip quite yet, but if Dancing Rob was paying attention, it didn't have enough time to get to it.
Oh!
But goes for the shield anyways.
The stage has so much pressure, as we do see the Swampert reaching for so much energy. It needs to strike hard and fast at this Lickitung to secure the knockout, but that bait was huge. No Protect Shield deployed here.
Yeah, Hydro Cannon is going to do significantly less damage than the Earthquake, but there are almost two more waiting for this Lickitung. Will Godin Hada get the opportunity to throw that Power Whip before the Swampert gets to this next Hydro Cannon? It's going to be close, but the Lickitung gets it.
One turn earlier, this Swampert is going to get Power Whipped off of the field here as Lickitung looks to dominate this matchup. The Switch Timer wasn't there, and he could not escape. Here comes the Galarian Stunfisk.
The Galarian Stunfisk does have a lot of energy available to it and will get to the Earthquake, but these trainers are closely closing in on a single Pokemon remaining in this match. It's going to be the Altaria versus the Galarian Stunfisk. There's not enough energy. The Galarian Stunfisk gets to the rock slide first, and we have a bracket reset.
Dancing Rob, a half second might determine his fate as he secures the knockout here on the Altaria against impossible odds. He resets the bracket. Neither of these trainers are going home yet.
We have at least a couple more games, possibly even five more matches or five more sets to go in this match to determine the first ever Pokemon Go Masters Division World Champion. And what an incredible set it has been so far, coming down to the last possible microseconds of game five of the first set. We have the bracket reset. We have these trainers already queued up, ready to go, and the mind games are just gonna continue rolling along.
You've had five games of interaction. That is not a typo. You've had five battles against this trainer. You've seen some tendencies. You've seen some team compositions. You need to recall these notes. Recall what your opponent is likely to do. How do they like to play out shielding situations? How do they manage their energy? Are they comfortable going down shields in these precarious situations? All this information needs to be distilled and gathered, because these critical moments, these battles right here, it doesn't matter what's happened in the past. You have to dump a lot of things through your memory except that last series, because this is it. These final five games will decide the first ever champion for Pokemon Go.
And if you think about it, not only is the pressure on, but the pressure just continues to get increased and increased and increased for these trainers. The longer period of time you spend on that stage with the lights, with the pressure, with the excitement, that just starts to really grate at your mental energy. And it's so important to take the time in between these matches to make sure that you're locked in, you know what strategy you want to do, you know what Pokemon are the major threats on your opponent's side of the field, and that you're able to continue to execute your strategy to perfection, because that's what it takes to become a world champion.
A half second, Gabby, a half second. We saw that Altaria reaching that Sky Attack as that final Dragon Breath gave it the energy it needed to deliver a knockout blow. We know as a species, Altaria would have won that Charge Move priority. It would have gotten to go first and fire its Charge Attack, but it never had the opportunity. So this opportunity, this key moment, this is when you really need to make the most of every single half second, every single turn on this World Championship stage.
Yeah, and Dancing Rob as well, leading that Galarian Stunfisk, I think really gave him the opportunity to get that energy on it so that that half second was already banked for later on in the match. I have to wonder, is he going to continue to lead the Stunfisk given how well it's done for him throughout this matchup? Or if it's time to make another prediction here in Team Preview that Godon Hada may bring the Shadow Kanto Ninetales or the Medicham in the lead to counter it again.
Well, we've seen time and time again that Shadow Kanto Ninetales coming out to answer that Galarian Stunfisk. Yes, you're dealing super effective damage with your Embers and Weather Balls. Yes, you apply a lot of pressure in terms of shields. But at the same time, the Galarian Stunfisk can strike back with the Rock Slides. It's not a clean-cut matchup. We have not really seen that Medicham from Godon Hada line up against that Galarian Stunfisk and really punish it for being in the matchup. I think that maybe is one of the keys to victory here, but Dancing Rob continues to alter his strategies, alter his approach, play around with the energy, and make these close victories work.
Everything is on the line here as these trainers take their time queuing into this first set of the bracket reset of Grand Finals. One trainer locked in, ready to go. The other trainer just taking a couple extra moments to think through their strategy, figure out who is the key Pokemon that they want to focus on, who is going to bring them to that incredible title of first ever Masters Division Pokemon World Champion. And as both these trainers are locked in, ready to go, let's go ahead and make some noise as this is the bracket reset. It's still the Grand Finals, and we once again have two Ninetales facing off on the field.
We see an instantaneous swap out from Dancing Rob to that Medicham. This Pokemon has been instrumental, a pivot point here for Dancing Rob as he looks to work his way out of the matchups, actually switching in the Registeel against this Medicham.
The Medicham going for a Psychic. As we've already established, Dancing Rob does not have access to Power Up Punch on his Medicham. Does a decent amount of damage, but these fighting type fast moves, I think, are more important and more valuable here. Godon Hada throwing the Zap Cannon will drop the attack of that Medicham.
It definitely slows this matchup down as these counters are dealing super effective damage, but the charge attacks are really a bit unreliable in terms of damage output. Maybe reaching for a double Ice Punch here? No, going straight for the Psychic, trying to secure a knockout on the Reggie Steele.
It's going to be close, waiting until the last possible second to throw that psychic, and just barely misses that knockout. The Reggie Steele throwing a focus blast into the Medicham, and Dancing Rob decides to shield it.
Medicham hits hard, but Reggie Steele proves it can hit back. It does take a protect shield there to maintain switch advantage, but that is actually pivotal here because those Ninetales do not like to see each other in that lead matchup, and we do have the Medicham delivering an ice punch here. This is just icing on the cake. This is just a little parting gift, if you will.
Yeah, you got to spend the energy if you have access to it, especially knowing that you're going to get knocked out almost instantaneously afterwards. Now that Galarian Stunfisk is out on the field for Dancing Rob, and that Ninetales is already ready to throw a charged move. Is it going to be an overheat? Is it going to be a weather ball? The Stunfisk is able to hold on, but there's another one queued up ready to go.
I think you have to save the Stunfisk at this point. You have no, you actually do not save it. This Shadow Canto Ninetales is too hot to handle. It's going to continue. Continue to apply pressure as the Alolan Ninetales comes in here, and this is the matchup we saw in the lead. This is something Dancing Rob wanted to avoid.
Yeah, Godan Hada also still has access to both of his shields. Dancing Rob using his last shield to take the overheat from the Ninetales, but Godan Hada just immediately switching out that Ninetales. The Ninetales just gets knocked out, so that attack drop doesn't even matter.
And this is actually critical because we haven't seen the wall rain much from Godan Hada, but we do see it in the matchup here, delivering the earthquake, securing the knockout here, and notching that first win under his belt of this grand finals reset. Godan Hada takes an early lead.
I wonder why we haven't seen the wall rain yet in this matchup. If you think about it, this is at least the sixth game that these trainers have played throughout this tournament, yet it was the first time we've seen the Shadow wall rain take the field. And honestly, it felt like quite a comfortable adjustment as it was able to outpace that Ninetales to the charged moves, to the earthquake even for the knockout there.
Yeah, Walrein is such a formidable Pokemon. We've seen that Pokemon time and time again here in the championship circuit. It's so powerful, it's so fast, it's so bulky, it's so dynamic, and it has really flipped a lot of matchups. But seeing it here, like you said, is a bit of an adjustment. I think the best answers that we've seen to that Shadow Walrein are the Medicham and the Galarian Stunfisk, and Dancing Rob has brought those Pokemon again and again and again, and we see that Shadow Walrein coming out anyway.
So good thing to note for Godan Hada, if you're able to keep that Walrein in the back, possibly after your Shadow Canto Ninetales knocks out the Galarian Stunfisk, that's just one more option you have in terms of your win conditions. There are some other Pokemon that we have not seen yet from these trainers. You know, I think we've seen a lot of Lickitung from Godan Hada throughout the tournament, but not so much in this matchup. I don't think we've seen too much of Dancing Rob's Lickitung either, which is something important to note as we're going through this game. I think that there is a lot to be said right now about the benefit of the surprise factor at the seventh game of this set. You start to know, you start to notice, you know, the short-term memory banks, even if you will, start to tell you what your opponent does, what your opponent favors. So if you're able to catch them off surprise just a little bit, that can make all the difference. But we're ready to start this next set, and it's Medicham versus Dancing Rob's Lickitung. Such an unfortunate start for Rob.
This is a bit tough for Rob, but this Lickitung will make this matchup close. Super effective lick damage coming through here on that Psychic type. Medicham is just whittling away at the HP, and again, the charge attacks here are critical. Looking for the same type attack bonus, Body Slam. Lickitung does strike first here.
It will connect, but this Medicham has Power Up Punch available to it, so these fighting type attacks are only going to get stronger and stronger. But Godan Hada throwing the Psychic straight first.
This Psychic coming through here will warp a little bit of the space-time around that Lickitung, and we do see the Lickitung mirror switch in here, but a tremendous health advantage here on the side of Godan Hada, and we finally see the Galarian Stunfisk come out to meet it. This is an interesting play as well. Sending out that Normal-type Pokemon typically pulls out a counter user like the Medicham, but Dancing Rob sending in the Stunfisk here.
I think that's okay. You know, if you go back to game five of the set, the Galarian Stunfisk having a little bit of extra energy on it did make all the difference for Rob. And it does feel like it's pretty comfortably sitting on the field right now. Godan Hada not shielding the earthquake, bringing that Lickitung down to half. You know, Rob does have time to try and make the Stunfisk work. And even though it is going to be trapped on the field, Both these trainers do have two shields available to them, but Dancing Rob deciding to just take the Power Whip.
Yeah, I think Dancing Rob recognizing the Power Whip is not quite enough to knock out the Galarian Stunfisk. He can get to the Earthquake. One eye on the switch timers as well is not going to allow Golden Hada to jump out of that matchup. Instead, going to deliver an Earthquake here, which will knock out the Lickitung if it doesn't get shielded, and it does not.
Both these trainers are content just saving their shields until the absolute last possible moment. It looks like the switch timer also has reset for Dancing Rob and Godan Hada, who immediately takes advantage of it to send in Registeel to Dancing Rob's Medicham.
Dancing Rob looking to pound away here on the steel type. Registeel actually reaching the charge move priority, throwing the psychic here. Medicham really would love a defense drop here to make this matchup more manageable.
The shield will stop the damage from that psychic, and no defensive drop comes through. Godan Hada throwing a zap cannon will be blocked by the protect, but also the attack drop will mean that these fighting type fast moves are dealing less damage to the Registeel overall, buying it just a couple seconds more of time.
Again, Registeel trying to manipulate the clock here, throwing another zap cannon here, but the psychic will come through here first. Medicham is in a pivotal position, and it does deliver the psychic. No protect shield used, but the Registeel still standing strong.
But there's the defensive drop right there. So if Medicham can find just a couple more seconds of damage against this Registeel, I guess overall with the second attack drop, maybe the equation still comes out to be the same, but that's more than enough time for this Medicham to win the matchup and then swap out and lose those attack drops overall.
As we see Godan Hada bring in the Medicham, then Lickitung pounces on the matchup. Is this a little bit risky though, because this Medicham might have an opportunity to counter it down?
Medicham in the red. These licks are super effective. It's coming down to the absolute wire, and the Medicham is the one that gets knocked out first for Dancing Rob. He is the winner of this set. It just feels like back and forth for these trainers. We're now going to be entering the eighth game overall of this grand finals as the score is tied 1-1.
I mean, if you're looking for two trainers that were evenly matched, I don't think you need to look anywhere else besides center stage at London. These two trainers are neck and neck. As soon as you think one trainer has an advantage, the other one storms back, and both of these trainers are just out to prove why they deserve to be in this position, why they deserve to be the first ever champion.
And with gameplay as back and forth as it is playing out on the stage, you can conclude that both these trainers really truly would be formidable world champions, but there can only be one. And I feel like the tricks and the strategies and the gameplay, we're just starting to see these trainers get so much time practicing against each other. How do you keep yourself centered on your game plan and stop yourself from just out predicting your opponent by like 3, 4, 5, 6 levels of mind games?
I was going to say these two trainers are going to get to know each other very well over the span of these two series, maybe even choreograph a dance afterwards. Who knows? Dancing Rob in the name. I had to reach for that one there. But we're going to see what happens here as Godan Hada looks to deliver a win here in this game number 3 of the Grand Finals reset. A slight reminder to everyone watching at home, this is an interesting development because Dancing Rob has not only reset the bracket, but he is threatening the winner's side bracket champion, who is Godan Hada here. This is a best of 5, 3 wins on the board, spell victory.
Dancing Rob just really taking his time to think through this matchup. I find it interesting that Godan Hada as well has also been consistently locking in his Pokemon prior to Dancing Rob. Could just be that he's maybe a little bit more comfortable going into these matchups and has that game plan already queued up, ready to go. Could also just be that Dancing Rob is taking this time to help center himself. You know, you have the opportunity to think here. You might as well use it, as every single second counts the second you start this game.
Yeah, I think every single moment, every single precious second, and if I could raise the stakes a bit, not just seconds, but half seconds, as we saw, that's all that Dancing Rob needed to reset this bracket, delivering that rock slide onto the Altaria. Again, the more games we play, the further away it feels, but this is very real. This is very in the moment. That was just a few minutes ago, and you need to secure some more close clutch victories in order to win this series. This is interesting in terms of adjustments because both of these trainers have shown a lot of their cards at this point in the series. They both felt each other out through 8 games here going on this 8th match. This is going to be very interesting to see if that Venusaur makes an appearance, if the Altaria shows up in the team composition, how these trainers are going to respond to each other because, again, at this point, they know each other pretty well.
Yeah, I also find it really interesting that we're seeing like consistently different Pokemon picks on each side of the field. These trainers, it's not like we've reached a point where they feel like, okay, this is my best possible chance of winning this matchup. You know, we're constantly seeing Pokemon swap in and pop out, and you know, these trainers make adjustments as they're going along, which I think also is just a testament to how close this matchup is. It's not like these trainers have sat down and cracked the code and decided if I don't do X, Y, and Z at this time in this place, then I unfortunately will not win this match. It's still very much a tug of war. This truly could be anybody's game, anybody's set at this point in time.
And that's what's so fascinating about this series as it plays on. You might look at these team compositions on paper and say, oh, there's a definite advantage for the trainer on the left. There's a definite disadvantage for the trainer on the right. And we thought that we saw that going in early, especially for that Shadow Venusaur. So many obstacles for it succeeding due to that team composition from our trainer on the left. But it's so tough, right? Because sometimes you can just bring neutral Pokemon and you can really show your skill ceiling, maximize all your opportunities, and take your best shot at your opponent, and it works out. And we've seen a lot of neutral play, a lot of feeling through the matchups as the series has continued. And like you said, it's not only a physical tug of war in the terms of the Pokemon battling, it's a mental tug of war. This is a test of endurance, and the first trainer that blinks is gonna be the one that falls.
Yeah, we were at mile 26. Now I think we're at mile 26.1. You know, you can see that finish line in the distance and you're just so close. You just have this last hurdle to go. And I can't help but wonder if one of these trainers is just gonna take off sprinting, you know, try and make a big read, try to make a big prediction, as opposed to playing this mental tug of war game after game after game to try to give themselves the advantage. And hypothetically speaking, if one of these trainers does decide to go for the breakout strategy, if you will, that's going to be such an interesting thing to watch play out, as it will be most likely very polarizing.
I just wanna mention as well, it's continuing with your running analogy. For example, let's say there's a rock in the road and you trip. Maybe that trip is in the form of just one turn late on a switch, maybe one wrong read on what your opponent might have in the back of their lineup. That is one stumble, one fall. That's all it takes for your opponent to just run off into the distance and put them over your shoulder.
I can't imagine what's going through these trainers' minds right now as well. Like I said, there's so much to keep track of. You know, I think it's great that I see some pens and paper, I think, on the desk down there. And I know that I've been taking notes. But it's so important to try and manage all this information and keep it just available and ready to go. This is it. I mean, we keep talking about it, but it's true. This is it. This is the moment that could define whether or not you're a world champion. And regardless of what happens, I gotta say, both these trainers have played so well consistently throughout the tournament, consistently throughout this grand final sets, their final sets. It's an absolute pleasure to watch them play right now. I just wanna know, like, what's going on? What are they thinking about? I almost wish that we had a little bit of a telepathy user here with us who could just give us a bit of an insight, you know?
I wish that as well. It'd be fascinating to see into the minds of these battlers. But then again, you just see through their actions as well. You see a lot of strategy play out, a lot of layers here to each of the techniques that they try to deploy throughout this tournament. But I want to take a second as well, Gabby, and just talk about the other competitors that have been here on the world stage. Everyone has so much to be proud of for being here in the World Championships. Only roughly 30 trainers qualified to be here out of the entire world of Pokemon Go players. That means something. That's something that you can carry into the next season with momentum, with pride in your heart. No matter where you finish, I think that's very, very impressive, and no one can ever take that away from you.
Yeah, something subtle that you may have noticed in our Worlds recap video that we showed, quite frankly, what feels like ages ago at the beginning of this set, was that all the competitors here this weekend are given a welcome bag that has some really cool Pokemon merchandise in it that's made especially to celebrate the fact that you qualified for the Pokemon World Championships. And that is no small feat. Many of these trainers had to either finish in the top two or top four of incredibly difficult tournaments to qualify here today. And we even saw a couple of trainers who had to, quite frankly, win an entire bracket of the last chance qualifier in order to move on to this day of competition. So even though we are down to the final two, every single person who competed here this weekend, whether you competed in the LCQ, the last chance qualifier, whether you competed in day one, day two of Worlds, truly has an incredible accomplishment to celebrate. And there's only more waiting in store. If you are watching this right now at home, and again, you think that you could be Godan Hada or Dancing Rob down there on the stage trying to figure out how to become the next Pokemon Go World Champion, check out Pokemon.com/play as all the information is there for you to join and compete and participate, make some amazing friends in the community, and be part of these amazing moments that we get to celebrate.
I want to make one point, and then I have one question.
All right, go for it.
So my point here is that you can participate in multiple regional competitions. Maybe you don't have your best showing in a regional competition. Maybe it's your first time going up there, battling other trainers face-to-face. Maybe your only exposure is in the Go Battle League. That's perfectly fine. There's definitely a degree of acclimation that goes on here as these trainers try to feel their way through the stage, through the atmosphere, through the pressure. And again, wherever you are battling, maybe it's on your couch at home, maybe it's at a local tournament in a grassroots circuit, it has a different feel, a different vibe. Yeah. There's a lot of energy that you have to kind of, I guess, you know, guide yourself through. And I think that giving yourself multiple opportunities to compete is key to acclimating again to those circumstances. So again, you can participate in as many of these regional competitions as you want, and sometimes it takes more than one try to get it right. But hey, if you do and you get to Worlds, it's worth it. My question for you, Gabby, is we've had two other fantastic, incredible co-casters here today, Steven Sanders and Caleb Peng. They're incredible casters, incredible talent here on the stage. But if those two battled in a world championship, who do you think would take the win there?
Oh, that's interesting, because the first thing I think of is that Caleb would be running Bastiodon, as that's his signature Pokemon. And I would hope that Steven or Butters would recognize that, you know, that Pokemon is making an appearance. I think that something that some people do is that, let's say their favorite Pokemon is Blastoise. They qualify for the World Championships. They don't care how they're doing. They're running Blastoise.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, Caleb is probably good enough to make it to the finals with a Bastiodon, regardless of what the metagame looks like. Mm-hmm. So if Butters decided to go for the hard counter into Caleb, expecting the Bastiodon, I think he would take it. But it could be mixed up. I think we should try and line up some caster battles in the future. But for now, I think we should finally get back to the stage, as it looks like these trainers are ready to go. The time for thinking is over. It is time to go into battle and take on the person blocking you from the title of world champion. Again, this is Dancing Rob. This is Godan Hada. They are tied 1-1 in this grand finals bracket reset. Both of these trainers are currently two wins away from becoming the first ever Pokemon Go World Champion. If you are watching at home, let us know who you're rooting for in chat. Are you rooting for Dancing Rob? Are you rooting for Godan Hada? Are you rooting for Turtwig, Altaria, Venusaur? Let us know in the chat, as this is it. This is that moment.
And we need to seize the opportunity here. We have two trainers. There is no next opponent. There is only this opponent and this moment. And in this moment, our trainers are locked in and ready to fly down to that stage as we are ready for game number three of our grand finals. We are only a few wins away. One of these trainers sitting in front of you will become a champion and the other will not. However, only time will tell. Both of our trainers have locked in their screens here. We might see a flip over in just a moment, or maybe just a quick refresh here as we get things queued up.
Yeah, you gotta make sure that you keep everything fresh.
You gotta keep things fresh.
You gotta keep things fresh. And unfortunately for us, that will mean we'll have to wait a couple more moments. But hey, if you're at home thinking to yourself, man, I should have gotten up and gotten some more water or gotten some popcorn, run. You have time, but you need to make that sprint of the last marathon mile, because if you are too slow, you may miss us crowning the first ever world champion here.
I just want to mention as well, all of the love and support that we've seen on social media is so incredible. All of the hashtag Pokemon Worlds hype, all of the Pokemon Go hype as well. It's so heartwarming to see everyone supporting their favorite trainers and just excited for this event. The viewership has been incredible. The interaction from the chats have been incredible. Thank you so much for supporting this competition, because this is just the dawn of a new age for competitive Pokemon Go, and we are making history here today. These trainers are going to refresh our applications, but I promise you we will get into these battles here shortly. I will say, 2-0 Butters does favor Shadow Charizard, and that
Pokemon really
struggles against the Bastiodon as well. So if he picks one of his favorites and Caleb picks one of his own favorites, it's going to be a little bit uphill. But Pokemon like Swampert, like Whiscash, can also provide a lot of problems for a Bastiodon team. So maybe he pivots more to a water and ground type Pokemon.
I don't know. It's, again, you're at the World Championships. Do you decide to run something that you think will absolutely destroy your opponent, especially knowing who your opponent is? Or do you just run with your favorite Pokemon? I think having been in that situation, I decided to make more of a meta play, but I tried to make my favorite Pokemon work. It was a Mega Metagross, which we don't have in the metagame quite yet for Pokemon Go, but still, that's enough talking about the old times. Let's go ahead back into the current time as these trainers are finally ready to go. This is going to be game three of the grand finals, and it's Altaria versus the Galarian Stunfisk.
This is essentially a best of three. Both of these battlers are tied up here, so the Lickitung counterswap into the metachamp. So much happened there, and I'll try to slow things down for us, but this Lickitung is applying a lot of pressure as we see the body slam come through here, and it will not receive a protection shield.
Again, Dancing Rob's Metacham only has access to Ice Punch and Psychic. It's not running Power Up Punch, and as a result is really forced to throw these Psychics against the Lickitung. But Godenhada, not saving those shields for later like we've seen him do in previous games, just goes for it immediately to block the Psychic.
No defense drop was triggered there, but the Psychic is Protect Shielded, applying a lot of pressure still with the counters. But look at that Metacham's HP. This Body Slam will definitely knock it out. What does Dancing Rob decide to do? He's weighing his options.
He lets it go. He decides to save the shields for later. Metacham goes down, but this gives the opportunity for that Galarian Stunfisk to come on right back in and get to that key Earthquake we saw it use earlier on in the set.
Looking forward with these teams on the screen, I think alignment is absolutely critical, and it looks like Dancing Rob is controlling that alignment thus far. He might have a favorable matchup down the stretch, but he's got to get through the Lickitung first, and this Rock Slide, I think, will be enough to knock it out.
It's going to be close. It connects, and it finds the KO. Godenhada down to his final two Pokemon. It's an Altaria and a Metacham, but you have to wonder what Pokemon Dancing Rob has in the back. He sends in the Metacham. This Galarian Stunfisk goes for the Earthquake first, but Godenhada doesn't shield it.
Godenhada not using a Protect Shield here, maybe recognizing something dangerous is in the back, and here it comes. We're in the danger zone as the Alolan Ninetales hits the field against the Metacham.
That Metacham tries to go for a charged move, but just doesn't have time to get it. Charm from this Alolan Ninetales is such a powerful move, and Godenhada not even shielding the Weather Ball from this Alolan Ninetales, as it will outpace this Altaria in damage, all thanks to that charm.
The Alolan Ninetales was inevitable there, defeating two Pokemon and giving Dancing Rob another victory. He is just one win away from being our first ever Pokemon Go World Champion. Gabby, this is what happens when you don't bring the Shadow Kanto Ninetales. When there is no Registeel on the opposing side of the field, that Alolan Ninetales is so dangerous.
And I have to wonder if Godenhada is going to make that same mistake twice. I think Dancing Rob just made a fantastic call again at team preview, recognizing that Godenhada either wouldn't bring that Registeel, or between the Galarian Stunfisk and the Metacham had enough offense to scare that Registeel away. Now that Dancing Rob is one win away from becoming the first ever world champion in Pokemon Go, I wonder, does Godenhada take that risk a second time?
That's a very interesting question and a calculation that he has made in his mind, as one of our trainers is already locked in. The other one is thinking things through, and I think we have a second lock in. This could be a pivotal matchup here as our two trainers go at it yet again.
Altaria on the field for Godin Hada, and Swampert is the lead for Dancing Rob. And Dancing Rob immediately trying to switch in the Medicham of all Pokemon against this Altaria.
This is actually a team composition that we've seen Dancing Rob carry on before. He knows that he will lose the one shield scenario here against the Altaria if both of these Pokemon invest a Protect Shield each. But the Ice Punch does deal some significant damage, super effective damage. And then we see the Altaria again gathering energy. This is almost feels like a script. We've seen this play out so many times in this series.
Yeah, that Altaria throwing the Sky Attack one split second before the Ice Punch was available to the Medicham. Dancing Rob using the first shield to keep that Pokemon safe. Does get to the Ice Punch here, but Godin Hada has more than enough time to go for that Protect Shield.
This is definitely a key moment of the matchup. Both of these trainers struggling to try to win switch advantage here as the Altaria's Dragon Breaths are piling on and reaching again for the Sky Attack just before the Ice Punch is queued up. Can Medicham withstand this attack? It cannot. Sky Attack will secure the knockout.
Dancing Rob would have had to go for that shield there, but having no shield with the Swampert and the Alolan Ninetales against this Altaria could be very dangerous. Ooh. As Swampert swaps onto the field for the Alolan Ninetales, trying to farm that Altaria and get the knockout. But Altaria just throwing that Sky Attack and forcing Rob to use his last shield.
Now here comes the Lickitung. This is why alignment is so key, as that water and ground type Pokemon squares off against the Lickitung with that incredible coverage attack of Power Whip. We do see the first Hydro Cannon coming through. Again, Lickitung able to withstand a lot of punishment, and it absolutely absorbs that first Hydro Cannon, actually throwing a charge with priority. Great counting there by Dancing Rob.
Yeah, both of these trainers are truly bringing their A game to this grand finals, as the Hydro Cannon barely misses the knockout on the Lickitung, but Lickitung able to connect a Power Whip against that Shadow Swampert. You know that's going to be a knockout.
It definitely does knock out the Shadow Swampert. Here comes the Alolan Ninetales, and guess what? We are back where we started. We have a Shadow Kanto Ninetales waiting in the wings to come out here and face off against the Alolan Ninetales, and here it is.
The Shadow Kanto Ninetales also having the shield advantage in this matchup, and all it will take is one Weather Ball to tie the set up once again. Two wins for Godin Hada, two wins for Dancing Rob. We are literally, finally, one game away from crowning our first world champion in Pokemon Go.
How in the world championships did we get here? Oh my goodness, this is so incredible to watch. From that last half second rock slide to reset the bracket from Dancing Rob to this pivotal moment. I think in the last game we saw, not this current one, but the previous, maybe two games ago, if I may say, we saw Dancing Rob kind of just dominate the matchup, the no Protect Shield on that Weather Ball from Alolan Ninetales, from Godin Hada just submitting the defeat. And then we see a return here with Dancing Rob accepting defeat. These trainers are evenly matched, and either of them deserves to be a champion today.
And I can't imagine just the pressure on these trainers' minds, because this is, again, going to be the 10th game of this set at this point in time. They've played through almost every single permutation of this matchup, and it just comes down to confidence and predictions and the mind games. There is no guaranteed strategy for both of these trainers to follow to get to that world champion title. They have to take every single second to think their strategy through, to remember the 9 games that preceded this one, and figure out what their opponent is going to do. What strategy, what Pokemon are they going to bring, and how can I be one step ahead to win the title?
Like we talked about yesterday, there are essentially two voices going on in each of these trainers' head. The first voice says, this is your only chance. You may never sit in this seat ever again at the World Championships. And the other voice says, this is my moment. This is my opportunity. I'm going to seize this championship, this victory, this glory. This is it. This is my time to become the first champion. And we are queued up here for a decisive game number 5.
Altaria takes the field against the Galarian Stunfisk from Dancing Rob. And you see him pump his fist in victory. The Galarian Stunfisk loves this matchup. Both these trainers, again, swapping. Now it's the Lickitung versus the Medicham.
And we've seen this play out a few times before. Lickitung going to apply some pressure here with a body slam. The question is, which one of these trainers is going to change the script? Which one is going to find that unique win condition?
Psychic is the move of choice for this Medicham, and the Lickitung going for an early shield this time around, not wanting to take any additional damage as these fast moves are starting to add up. Will outpace the Medicham to the body slam and waits until that last possible second to throw, and Dancing Rob just conceding this matchup, letting the Medicham go, not investing any more shields.
Godin Hada's mastery of these one-turn fast attacks is just absolutely spectacular as he's able to throw these attacks again and again and deny his opponent their own charge attacks. We do see the Power Whip getting queued up here as well. This Galarian Stunfisk can very comfortably absorb this attack, and the Rock Slide might be enough to KO as well, but how much energy does Dancing Rob want to gather first?
I think he wants to gather as much energy as possible, getting to a second Rock Slide. Does throw the first one for the knockout on the Lickitung, but look at the targets for the second. There's the Altaria and that Shadow Canto Ninetales in the back of Godin Hada's party. If this Galarian Stunfisk finds the right alignment, it's actually the Shadow Canto Ninetales that takes the field.
And this is so critical. We do see the Rock Slide come through here. The Protect Shield gets forced as well. Can Shadow Canto Ninetales carry Godin Hada to victory or not?
It will not take damage, and it will be followed up by a second Rock Slide, and there are no more Protect Shields remaining for Godin Hada. Has the Weather Ball ready, but it's a switch, and now the Alolan Ninetales is out on the field. Once again, it's a Ninetales versus Ninetales showdown, and the Weather Ball is thrown from Godin Hada. Dancing Rob blocks it with a shield.
We do see that charm sneak through there and KO that Shadow Canto Ninetales. Altaria is on the field. Alola Ninetales looking to deliver victory for its trainer.
That Weather Ball will connect and pick up some major damage against this Altaria. Will it have the opportunity to throw one more charge move, or will Charm just knock it down? And Dancing Rob is your first ever Pokemon Go World Champion in the Masters Division.
This is where legends are made. The first ever Pokemon Go World Champion is before your eyes. Years of trial, experience, and practice and work has led to this moment, and it is a beautiful one to see.
Having come all the way from the loser's side of the bracket, winning the bracket reset in the critical game five, winning the critical game five in the reset to become the world champion, Dancing Rob truly has mastery of this game. You can see exactly why he was able to take the crown. But Godin Hada as well, that game was just so close. It was a consistent back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Both these trainers should be very proud of their accomplishments here today.